Yeah, well.
No.
Maybe feelings of boredom, maybe even intimidation. I think those feelings that a lot of people have are because of, first of all, a misconception about what math actually is, as well as the way that it's presented. So a lot of people are surprised to find out that math actually isn't all about numbers. That there are abstract fields such as mathematical logic, as well as group theory, that don't involve numbers, at least inherently. Actually, what math is all about is patterns. So in the case of logic, it's patterns of rational reasoning, or valid reasoning. And in the case of group theory, it's patterns of certain algebraic structures and symmetry. And so these have to do with music, with a lot of other things as well. And so because of these these patterns, you can really tie in very seemingly unrelated subjects. Like, for instance, there are numbers involved with black hole event horizons that are actually the same numbers found in the spiral of a pine cone. So we're going to see tonight how music is actually related to certain concepts like the Rubik's Cube, the mathematics, and that explains chord progressions and harmonic relationships. So we're going to get into group theory as a field, talk about what a group is mathematically. So in everyday usage, a group is just a collection of things. But mathematically, these elements have to satisfy certain laws called axioms. So I'll list the four axioms that they have to satisfy. And then as we go, the notation is not necessary to understand to get the idea, but I'll explain the notation as well. So the first one, so that upside down A right there is called the universal quantifier. It just means for all. So for all elements, this is the element in set theory in G, our potential group. A operation B is also in G. This is the operation symbol. So when we're checking a collection of elements against the axioms, it's according to a particular operation. So it could be addition, multiplication, or something else. And this isn't always given because, for example, the negative integers under multiplication is not closed because a negative times negative is not another negative, so it's not closed in the group. So some of these might seem at first a little bit arbitrary and unrelated, but we'll see as we go on some examples. And then we'll get into the musical application. And then toward the end, I'll play some excerpts, and then two complete pieces at the end. So the second axiom. So not to be confused with commutativity. Associativity is just by changing the order of operations, it doesn't change the result. So by doing A operation B first and then C is the same thing as B operation C operation A. So that's associativity. Thank you. some element E, so such that, that's the vertical bar, when A operation E is applied, the result is A. So this is a really complicated way of saying that it doesn't change the result. So like the multiplicative identity is 1 because 1 times a number is that number. In addition, it's 0 because 0 plus a number is that number. It's actually pretty simple, it just looks really complicated. Okay, so the last axiom is the inverse axiom. This is not the reciprocal exponent. This is specifically talking about the inverse element of A. So every element in the group has an inverse, so that when the operation is applied between the two, the result is the identity element. Okay, so this might seem really complicated, but we'll look at an example using just 3 numbers and see how it satisfies this. We'll look at a geometric example of what these axioms actually mean geometrically, and most importantly, symmetrically, and then how this applies to music theory. So if I were to take the integers 0, 1, and 2 under addition, we'll see that these actually satisfy all the axioms. So, first of all, to explain a concept called modular arithmetic before we go on, imagine a clock, and it's 11 o'clock, and I were to ask, what is it going to be in 2 hours? Now, you're not going to say, no, this is barring military time. So, 11 o'clock plus 2 equals 1 o'clock. So, you're saying 11 plus 2 equals 1. That's the basic idea of it, because in our set of elements under modular arithmetic, we cycle back to the first number in the sequence. So there's no 3, so in answer to the question, is 2 plus 2 always equal to 4? No, it's not. This may be surprising, but if we add 1 plus 2, we actually get 0 under mod 3. So under that, think of the same principle as the clock face. So you're just cycling back around to the first number again. Now, because of that, it's closed under modular arithmetic, mod 3. Associativity, if you change the order of operations, it doesn't change the results. So 0 plus 1 plus 2 is the same thing as 0 plus 1 plus 2. The identity element, as we mentioned in addition, is 0 because 0 plus 1 is 1 and 0 plus 2 is 2. 2 and 1 are inverse elements because 2 plus 1 mod 3 equals 0. So if we write this out, there are the operations. If we apply 0 plus 0, it doesn't change anything. 1 plus 1 is going to give us 2, and so on. Okay, so probably not very exciting. But if we look at what the musical application for this is, if we look at the integers as actually elements on the piano, which I'll explain in a minute, we come to the concept of an interval, which is just the distance between notes. And the intervals start as the perfect first. This is just a note to itself. We might call it the zero in addition. If you say what's a note to itself, you're not changing anything. Then from there we expand to a minor second. You can see up here, written out, minor second, so from C to C sharp, from C to D, to C to E flat or D sharp, to C to E, C to F. This is a tritone, the augmented fourth or diminished. actually addition mod 12. This is actually a lot like a clock face. So if we were to ask how many different notes there are on the piano, not how many different keys, how many different notes, there are 12 because all the rest are just repeats. So if we were to just cut out everything besides between C and B, we end up with 12. The octave starts the process over again. So right now we're concerned with basically 0 through 11. So it's like our clock face, but instead of 1 through 12, it's 0 through 11. So by adding the perfect first, just like adding 0, it doesn't change anything. Adding a perfect first to a perfect fifth keeps the perfect fifth. And it's closed because just like the clock face, we cycle around. In fact, if it were 11 o'clock and I say, what is it going to be in 48 hours? It's still going to be 11 o'clock because 48 is divisible by 12. Same thing here. If you take any number and add a multiple of 12 to it, it's going to stay the same because it cycles around in modular arithmetic. Associativity, the same thing happens if you were to add parentheses and change the order of operations, the interval is kept the same result at the end. The identity element, this is going to be, as you mentioned, 0. Adding it doesn't change anything. Now the inverse axiom, this is the most interesting because now we get into inversions. So if we were to take the major third, which, so I'll play an example. So C to E, that's a major third. If I were to switch the order of them, so now it's E to C, it's a minor sixth. Now a major third inverts to a minor sixth. If we were to add them together, we get an octave. But now remember, in mod 12 arithmetic, we cycle back around and we get back to C again. So adding a major third plus a minor sixth gives us our identity element. That with the perfect fifth and the perfect fourth. So the perfect fifth over here, the perfect fourth. And that's an important concept that we'll talk about in a few minutes when we get into the circle of fifths. So we see that it's a group and it's still not very exciting, but we'll look at an example now of a specific type of group. So we're going to go back to math now. And feel free to answer this if you feel up to it. How many different ways can I rearrange these three numbers? Somebody say six?
Mm-hmm.
Yep, six. And the easiest way to explain that is using factorials. Three factorial is six. Three times two times one. And now let's see what this means geometrically. We have 0, 1, and 2. Now, how do we get the six different permutations? Well, the first is just by picking it up and putting it back down. That's our starting position. So we're going to name that E. We'll see in a minute, but it has to do with our identity element. So E equals, let's make some room. How do we get the other permutations? Does anybody have a guess? What can we do to it so that it looks the same, but the numbers are in a different order? Rotate it? Yeah, that's right. So if we do that, we do it once. We can name this alpha sub 1. We do that 0, 1, 2, turns to 1, 1, 2, 0. Right? So now it's in this order. We'll go back to our starting position. And then what if we do that twice? starting position. So we could say that alpha sub 1 plus alpha sub 2 equals E. Remember the inverse axiom? They're inverse operations of each other. Okay, about the other three permutations, we can flip it.
Yeah.
So if we draw a line of symmetry right here and we do this, the 0 stays where it is, but the 2 and 1 are flipped. So we'll name this okay. And if I do it twice, it takes us back to the beginning again. So each reflection is its own inverse. Okay, so if I do the same thing with this vertice, it does the same thing. So those are all our permutations for a visual representation of 0, 1, and 2 and what we can do with it. Now, before we go back to music and see what the application is, there's the concept of a subgroup, and a subgroup is where we take elements from a group as a set, a subset, and it still satisfies the group axioms. So if I were to take, for example, satisfies the group axioms because 2 plus 2 is 0 mod 4, so it's its own inverse. 0 is the identity element, it's associative, so it's a subgroup. So now, let's do you mind if I turn it around now? From that group and form a subgroup. So we know that one of them has to be the identity element, because it has to satisfy the identity axiom. We also know that each element has to have an inverse, so we have to add up to 12. So if you think about all of the integers mod 12, that could be, if you want three elements, the other two numbers have to add up to 12. So we do 4 and 8. We could do 0, 3, 6, 9, because 6 is its own inverse. 6 plus 6 mod 12 is 0, and 3 and 9 added together give us 12. So if we, let's just call it, A, this is because of the musical comparison, you might call it something else, but we also do all the even integers plus 0, because 6 is its own inverse, 4 and 8 are inverses, 2 and 10. So that also forms a subgroup. We'll just mention that one, because all of this has to do with symmetry, and when you hear the musical examples, it'll start to make sense. But let's actually see what these represent. So I'm going to use a different color for each of them. From C to E to E sharp. So tonal center. And we'll talk about tonal centers in a minute. There's generally a lack of tonality. So when it comes to scales or harmony, the less symmetrical it is, the more tonally stable it is. So going back to the triangle, all of the permutations for the triangle, let's use a musical analog for the same exact principle. In fact, you'll see that a lot of music terms can just be interchanged with math terms, and it doesn't change the meaning. This is really good. So if I were to take my like we could invert an interval, like the C and E, we could change the order so that it's E to C. We could also do that with a chord. So now I'm going to play a major chord because it's easier to hear the actual difference when I invert it, because an augmented chord, every inversion sounds the same because of the symmetry. But if I were to play C major, so that's root position. If I were to take the bottom note and put it on top but keep the other two notes the same, it's first inversion, and now second. Now if I do it again, I end up back in root position again. In other words, also 2 equals our identity element. It's root position. So C, we invert it once. The reflections, these give us bigger chords that might be spread out between two hands or across an orchestra if you have a large hand span, but they're a lot bigger than the traditional root position, first and second inversions. So basically, chord inversions are the same thing as permutations, the same exact concept. So, the other subgroup that I mentioned, the even numbers, that actually gives us the whole tone scale. So, this is what this sounds like. You'll hear it in one of the examples. Sequence of whole and half steps, a half step being the very next note up or down, and the whole step just being two of those. So sharps and flats, the sharp is just a half step up and a flat is a half step down. Double sharp is a whole step up and a double flat is a whole step down. So the whole tone scale is, it has no tonal center. Whereas a C major scale, if I were to play a C major scale and I keep going, you'd be able to tell when it stops because of the relationship between asymmetrical intervals. So like if I were to play, it doesn't sound finished. Now it does, because of that asymmetry. Now one last math concept is called a cyclic group. And so a cyclic group is just a group that has what's called a generator element, that when the operation is applied, it generates the entire group. So with our 0, 1, and 2, 1 is a generator element because 1 plus 1 equals 2 plus 1 equals 0 mod 3, and it generates the whole group. Not all groups have a generator element, but what's interesting is which generator elements our intervals actually contain. So if you look at all of these numbers, think about note numbers, keeping in mind mod 12 arithmetic, will generate all 12. The symmetrical numbers that are actually in subgroups won't do it, because they're just going to oscillate. They're going to cycle around in the same pattern. But if we use the asymmetrical numbers, not all of them, because remember the even numbers are also in that, we just didn't outline it. One, in addition, generates all the integers, and its inverse 11 also does. Now if we were to add 11 plus 11 mod 12, we get 10, plus 11 is 9, plus 11 is 8, so we generate in reverse order. Now in music, this is all this is. More interesting example is the other generator elements. There's two other ones. And before we talk about what those are, we're going to rearrange the numbers a little bit. What we're going to do is switch every other one. Yeah, circle of fifths. Very good. And so here's the basic idea of what this circle of fifths is. Like I mentioned, the scale, the diatonic scale, the major and minors, are a specific sequence of whole and half steps. Now, so for a major scale, it's whole, whole, half, whole, 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 half. Now, if I were to go up a perfect fifth, and do the same thing starting on the fifth note in the scale. So from C, stop on G, and do the same sequence. Now it would be all natural notes except for one, and that sharp that we add is going to be a half step below our starting note, so it's F sharp. And now if I do the same thing on D, keep the F sharp, add a half step below D, which is C sharp. And we keep doing that, and it's a logical way of organizing the keys so that it makes sense. Now, let's go back to the generator elements. So if I were to add 5 plus 5, already laid out as the circle of fifths, but if you were to add 5 plus 5 mod 12, so 10, plus 5, we're going to get 2, plus 5 is 7, and so on. So what we're doing is we're generating the notes by fourths. So if we were to go backwards, this is C to F, B flat. That's, we're basically adding 5 plus 5. If we go the other way, we're adding 7, because the perfect fifth is our interval number 7. So if we add 7 plus 7, that's 14, but mod 12 is 2, and so on, we generate the circle of fifths. So it's cyclic because it has multiple generator elements. Okay, so now we'll get into what this actually has to do with the sound. In music, so we talked about the tonal center, how you can tell when a scale stops because of the asymmetrical relationships, that last half step tells you when it's supposed to end. Now, the third scale degree is very important because the position that it's in determines if it's major or minor. So listen what happens if I lower the third scale. I'm going to use a G scale because one of the musical examples is using G as a tonal. So what if I lower the third scale degree? So that's minor. Now, harmonically, it's major, and that's minor. So that's with the lower third scale degree. Now, the chord is constructed with three intervals. We talked about how the interval is the distance between notes. So any chord has an outer interval, a lower interval, and an upper interval. So with the major and minor triad, which is just a chord that has three notes, the outer interval is a perfect fifth. Now, the perfect fifth is it cannot be divided by one note symmetrically. So you have to choose either major or minor. Now, if I were to extend the perfect fifth into a minor sixth, now I can do that because I can divide it into a major third and a major third. And so, on our Cayley table on the other side, a major third plus a major third equals a minor sixth. Now, and that gives us our augmented chord. So the augmented chord is symmetrical. The major and minor chords are asymmetrical. So the tonal stability that we hear in music is actually because of asymmetry. Now, sometimes though, composers would, probably not intentionally, but they would kind of take the average between these two asymmetrical harmonies. So it's hard to tell if it's major or minor. I'll play a piece by Shostakovich, and the tonal center is G. The only thing is the melody uses a B natural, so one would think that it's G major. The only thing is the harmony uses a B flat, so then it's G minor. So which is it? Well, I'm not going to tell you. I'll play the example and let you hear what the actual effect is. And it'll stop abruptly because the quartet kind of runs as one continuous piece. You can't have to play the entire 22-minute piece otherwise. So that illustrates tonal ambiguity. It's hard to tell if it's major or minor. Now it is in the minor mode, and it uses the B flat more than the B natural. So there is a little favoritism there, but it is ambiguous. Oh yeah, so I'm going to play another example as we use more symmetrical properties. Because that example used two asymmetrical. So it kind of averaged as symmetrical, but it's still not truly symmetrical. So if we start to use more of the whole tone scale, the augmented triad, the diminished seventh, and the tritone, as well as chromaticism, all of those mathematical generator elements, subgroup from the patient group, here what happens. So that you can hear what actually atonal music is, and it might remind you of hitting wrong notes. Hopefully it deepens your appreciation for the musical process and the properties that make music music. So whether it's symmetrical or asymmetrical, all of those things have to do with math. So that concludes the lecture part of this. My aim was to really make it interesting to those that have any formal training in math or music, but still accessible to those without it. So were there any questions that you can think of that I didn't cover, anything that was unclear, or that you'd like to be further informed about? Chris?
So can you talk a little bit about how you use these?
Actually, the last one was my own, and it was in addition to using a cyclic group in order to continue the process without stopping at a certain point. There's another concept called an iterative function. So if you've ever seen the Mandelbrot set, that's a function under iteration. It's basically where you take the answer, it's x squared. Generates a new answer, and you keep doing that. And so C is a constant from the set of all complex numbers, and zero is the seed, and all the answers that don't escape to infinity, those are the answers you keep, and it plots out the Mandelbrot set. So in the musical example, the musical phrase was iterated through a particular function, as it were. It iterated through a cyclic function so that it would not terminate. So, does that answer your question?
Okay. I mean, do you use similar, for much of your compositional process, are you using different types of mathematical equations and or processes?
Yeah, I'd say about half of them, in some way or another. The last piece I'm going to play actually uses it in the cadenzas. It's very tonally stable. I thought to give everyone a break from all the tonally ambiguous music, I'd play something that's more pleasing. So I'll play a piece by Froberger. And then my variations on Gounod's Funeral March of the Marionette, which if you've ever seen Alfred Hitchcock Presents, it's the main theme from that, so you might recognize that. So, are there any questions? Any other questions? Yes. Oh yeah, yeah. Multiplication can definitely be used in groups. In fact, it's probably every bit as common as addition. As far as the musical application, I'm not sure. But,
do you have it like messed with it when you use
it? I've thought about it, but addition keeps me so busy. Venture into the spirit almost multiplication. Thank you. just keep, listen for the middle section. When it starts to get more tonally ambiguous, you might start to notice some of these concepts.
Thank you.